be here.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. And for those who are standing in the back, there are some seats over on the side here. So if you want to come down, come sit with Julie. Julie's really cool. She would love to sit with you. Come on.
And no one's making a move.
And there's a seat. There's a couple seats down here in the front as well. There's little spots we can squeeze in. We're going to include your questions and comments as we go through the evening. But I just wanted to, first of all, introduce our guests, and then I'll ask a few questions and throw out a few thoughts for the discussion. And I do really want to make sure we include those in the audience as well. So all the way down at the far end is, he's a writer, both of journalism and he's written some really cool books. Has anybody read Pictures at a Revolution?
Yes.
And Grantland, his work in Grantland and for other publications, as well as the book Five Came Back. Please welcome Mark Harris. Effie Brown has produced many, many films. Real Women Have Curves among them. Dear White People, she had a film here at New Directors, I think it was last year, maybe it was two, 2 years ago, but certainly recently. And she's currently appearing on HBO's project Greenlight. Effie Brown. Next to Effie is Susan Lewis, who's worked at MTV Films, and she's an executive at AK Worldwide. Welcome, Susan Lewis. Mynette, Louie in the center is a producer. She's produced numerous films, including Mutual Appreciation, recently Land Ho, and she's also launched a new initiative, which we'll talk about certainly this evening, Game Changer Films. Mynette, Louie, welcome. And Ira, your resume is too long for me to read because you've produced so many movies, repped so many films, started companies, and not only that, but Ira is also at Columbia University. So please welcome Ira Deutchman. Rose McGowan is an actress and a director. We were thrilled to have her here. I guess it was over the summer now, time has flown, with a screening and conversation about her film Dawn. She's also an actress, been in many, many films, including Death Proof, Grindhouse, numerous others. Welcome, Rose McGowan. And again, with Lydia, there's so many films I could mention. I'm just going to mention a couple. And The Lunchbox, Cutie and the Boxer, Darjeeling Limited, Talented Mr. Ripley. Please welcome producer Lydia Dean Pilcher. Okay. It was interesting to me on Friday night that Michael Moore, in talking about his new film, Where to Invade Next, near the end of the conversation, asked a question of kind of everybody in the room. And that is, he asked, what stories are we missing? Why can't we make more films by women? How are we going to look? We're going to look really bad in the future with a population that is majority female, and yet so few films are directed by women. It was a comment that I've been thinking about a lot this weekend, but I want to take a step back for a moment to sort of set the stage for this conversation. And that goes back to 3 weeks ago when my colleague Brian Brooks and I, Brian who introduced the panel, we read the piece in the New York Times on the cover of the Arts and Leisure of the Fall preview. And I'm going to read just a couple of quotes from it because it really is what inspired this conversation. And a number of things that happened after that panel led to the group that we have in front of you and to creating this opportunity for us to have this discussion. A.O. Scott in the New York Times in that Sunday cover. He's talking about the success of Universal Studios, the studio. There's no doubt that Universal led the pack in releasing movies that people were eager to see, to tell their friends about, and to see again. These included Trainwreck and Straight Outta Compton, which beat expectations and also taught Hollywood and the entertainment press a lesson periodically learned and too often quickly forgotten. Women go to the movies. Black people, too. And more than that, movies that reflect the demographic reality of the world we all inhabit can have a very wide and profitable appeal. which is only to state the obvious fact that a lot of the ticket buyers for Compton were white, and a lot of the Trainwreck fans were men. And a lot of the summer's most exciting movies, Inside Out, Mad Max, among the blockbusters, Diary of a Teenage Girl, and Grandma among the indies, have been about women. It goes without saying, although it's always worth saying again, that Hollywood remains a hotbed of sexism and retrograde gender politics, especially where the hiring of women directors is concerned. But there does seem to be something of a shift underway. Manohla Dargis responded, this is very brief, the big studios deserve to be repeatedly lashed for their lack of diversity. But it's also true that change is inevitable, partly because of the country's shifting demographics, and that it has always begun on screen and off. An August 25th report from the Directors Guild states there has been what it calls modest improvement in the number of women hired to direct for television and the internet. So it was reading some of those comments, followed by, in quick succession, any other number of comments. Effie on Project Greenlight, Marion Cotillard's recent comments about feminism, Emma Watson's comments by Matt Damon, comments by Roland Emmerich regarding Stonewall. All of this got us talking, and I'm sorry to go on, but I wanted to sort of set the tone. All of this got us talking at the Film Society about this moment we're in. And I wanted to bring together, we wanted to bring together this panel to help us understand the moment we're in, because everyone on this panel is on the front lines of creating entertainment, content, and stories, telling stories for audiences. It's a really interesting, I have to go to Effie first, because after reading this article, I think it was later that night, watching Project Greenlight.
What happened?
Something happened.
What?
I can read quotes about what happened. You all probably saw it already, so I won't do that now, and we can come back to it, but Effie, you tweeted very quickly thereafter that a conversation was started. You appreciate that a conversation was started.
I did. You know, and I did tweet immediately of being Tuesday. I was terrified, actually. I mean, just to have a real conversation, you know? After I knew, because we would see those cuts a little bit ahead of time.
Did everybody watch Project Greenlight? Has everybody seen the clips of?
All right, so Project. You saw the kid mom. It's riveting. it's really sort of heartbreaking. Like, I can't watch them now. But we were choosing the director. There were some off-the-cuff comments that were made about diversity and how you are diverse in the casting of a film, not necessarily behind the scenes, and how somehow, and I'm, you know, paraphrasing, being diverse somehow supersedes, you neglect merit. I mean, I'm trying to say, I totally disagree with what was said, so I don't know how to paraphrase.
Well, let me just help you out with one thing. Quoting Effie, they're discussing the casting of a film and then how to hire a director for this film on Project Greenlight. Quote, I would just want to urge people, whoever the director is, the way they're going to treat the character of Harmony, she said. Her being a prostitute, the only black person being a hooker who gets hit by her white pimp.
And it's a comedy.
Quoting Matt Damon, when we're talking about diversity, you do it in the casting of the film, not in the casting of the show. Effie's response was, whoa.
Wow, okay. And it was pretty shocking. I mean, I don't really know how to go on about the conversation, but it was pretty shocking because I raised a red flag earlier seeing a previous cut of it, and I was like, yo, you guys are gonna keep that in? And then they sort of cut it further, and that was the nice cut, all right? So be duly noted on that. So, and then Tuesday happened, to be real about it, I couldn't go head on against the biggest movie star in the world. Do you know what I mean? I want to work again. I am a producer. Well, I mean, this is a thing I think all of us have to think about. You know, I'm a ballsy chick, but I'm also like, he has a number one movie and probably going to win an Oscar. You know what I mean? I'm trying to pay my mortgage so Chase doesn't take it. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, so that's where I'm coming, you know, that's where I'm coming from. But what I loved is that what was brilliant is that with social media, there was an immediate call and response. It was the conversation, the people that tweeted, Facebooked, got out there, that it was quickly acknowledged, oh, this is no longer okay. That what you feel, that you cut to make it seem palatable to the people were still like, this is some bullshit. Hopefully, and this is being filmed, so I'm gonna stop right there.
Can I chime in? I think that's a big reason, social media is a big reason why, you know, people can't get away with that kind of stuff anymore. I mean, all the Stonewall boycott, yeah, the Aloha whitewashing, you know, even the Mikado, Gilbert and Sullivan pulling that because of the yellow face and them canceling the show entirely. I think that social media has given people of color and women a voice, and we're really loud. We can be really loud and really just kind of change the way Hollywood thinks about, oh shit, we gotta pay attention to these people now.
Yeah.
Lydia, did you see this exchange?
Yeah, yeah.
And I wonder how you processed it.
Well, I actually think it's amazing, and it's great that it happened, because I think that what he said, what he uttered, exhibits the lack of understanding about cultural diversity in Hollywood. And it's the kind of thing that gets said all the time,
every day,
and we don't get to hear it. It's behind closed doors. But, you know, those of us who are producers, and we, you know, we're involved in every step of the pipeline, from development to financing, production. It goes all the way to distribution and exhibition. I mean, it's a conversation that's dominated by, and the thing that really frustrates me, and I realize that I think is the biggest part of the problem, is, you know, is that they don't get the value of diverse voices, of diverse perspectives. So the idea that diversity is just reflected in casting, I mean, yes, that's important, but it's not the end of the beginning, so. I think it's an amazing thing to have happened, and I think it should keep getting talked about. I know it will keep getting talked about, and it should be pointed to, because it's a disconnect. I mean, I'm sure that, you know, there's so many people that are like, yeah, he said that, yeah, so, So, you know, it goes on. Yeah.
Like, you know, yeah.
It goes on in an extremely real way, and knowing it from the inside to the out, I've had, because I've been perceived as not having power for so long, the things that have been said to me and done to me, but also in another note, like regarding that like kind of situation, that I've been replaced 3 times, and they straight up said, you know, well, we need to make our black quota. You've been replaced by a black woman, but it's because we need to make our quota. And these people have no shame, and there's no idea that something is wrong. There's literally no shame. And it's I'm like, fine, cool, go, like, whatever.
Go get your black woman.
Fucking do it. And you're right. But also, you're wrong. And you're wrong in the way you disseminate this information. You're wrong in the way you think. There's a fundamental, inherent wrongness in the way they think, in the way they function, in the way they treat the world. And what I see and how I perceive it to be how they treat women and others behind the screen is how it's treated on the screen, is how they're treated in the world. And it's a cycle, and it's a cycle. Go ahead.
I would just say there was I tend to feel there's a very dismissive quality to the way that people talk, and I actually get to hear a lot of the things that people say. The questions, the remarks, you know, I was on a phone call once with a big executive who was giving us feedback on a black woman's script and her demeanor in a meeting. And the feedback was, well, the head of our studio didn't like her because she's too polite. She doesn't curse enough. She doesn't curse enough. So next time she comes in, can you make her like a little messier, just a little.
And that's how they want.
And that's how.
But damned if you do, damned if you don't.
If she came in like that, if
it
she came
an
in and
woman.
She cursed
and
she
she's
said
like not
she
polished
behaved
enough.
The way they wanted her to behave, then it would have been the opposite, right? There. I can go on with the number of times people.
Yeah,
can I mansplain diversity mansplain now? Mansplain it, exactly.
So what are y'all thinking?
Let me do one thing. Let me read a quote. Matt Damon, after numerous days, it took a while, responded in Entertainment Weekly, and then, you know, not just because Mark used to work at Entertainment Weekly, I'll ask you to give a journalistic context to this. Quote, I believe deeply that there needs to be more diverse filmmakers making movies. I love making movies. It's what I've chosen to do with my life, and I want every young person watching Project Greenlight to believe that filmmaking is a viable form of creative expression for them, too. My comments were part of a much broader conversation about diversity in Hollywood and the fundamental nature of Project Greenlight, which did not make the show. I'm sorry that they offended some people, but at the very least, I'm happy that they started a conversation about diversity in Hollywood that is an ongoing conversation that we all should be having.
Aren't we sick of having a conversation?
Exactly!
God, I'm bored of it. I mean,
we gotta do something. Stop talking about it.
As an audience member, I beseech people that are making movies to just, like, you and you and you, like, just stop. Like, enough. Like, I shouldn't be on a panel about diversity. I'm a white fucking woman. God damn it. You know what I mean?
What about me?
And you. What's your problem? I'm gonna yell at you now.
That's why, like, I'm here.
I'm part Indian. Yeah. But true. But I don't look like it. But the thing is that we're 50% you. Of the population. What the fuck?
I want to use that. I'm a white woman. I should not be on a panel about that. I
shouldn't.
I love it. It's.
But I mean, thank you for asking me.
But I think gender bias does deserve some focus and attention.
Completely. Gender bias deserves huge focus and attention. Yeah. But
can I talk about this idea of meritocracy that Matt Damon brings up? Mm-hmm. You know, I think a lot of white men toss this term around as if it's an objective scientific term, forgetting the fact that 80% of film critics are male. 80% of film critics are male. Probably 90% are white. So it's like, you know, what's a good movie is defined by white men, and it's sort of like, you know, you have to think about meritocracy in a shift, you know, in a way that's much more broad than that, obviously. And you know, I think that the diverse perspectives that on Project Greenlight that filmmaking team that Effie was talking about would bring a different perspective to Harmony, that has merit to it, you know, having that different
and not only that, just to sort of shed a little bit more light to that, that directing team was previously picked by all of them. So all of those 13 directors had merit. And it was just interesting to me, by me talking about two of them, we talked about a lot of people during that day, but me talking about the two of them, all of a sudden they became, in my perception, and what I perceived in the conversation, as less than, because they were somehow diverse, so that made them less than, and that's how the conversation took a turn. I will say this, because I'm sure we all want to work with Matt Damon sometime in the future. That I don't, you know, Rose is like, yes, girl, okay. But I was saying, I don't want to be like, we're bashing the dude, because I do feel that his view, in his mind, it made sense. And I do feel it was the view of quite a few people, because it made it on. And I don't feel that he's a malicious person. And I don't feel they're malicious. And what's worse is, they just don't think about us. Do you know what I'm saying? So, like, that's why I don't want to, like, bash the dude, because then we're going to give him real ammunition, and I want to work again.
Just to add a couple of things to this about Matt Damon's statement, I think that the one step in the right direction that it took was that he stopped using the word we or you and started using the word I.
Right?
At least he was speaking for himself, whereas in that room, you know, whenever I hear either something negative, like, you know, you don't do diversity in the show, you do diversity in the casting, or even something positive, like, we really need to make more of a diversity effort, you always have to think, who's the we? Who's the you? Because if it's five white guys in a room saying we need to do something about diversity, the result is not going to be the same. As soon as you view diversity as a problem to be solved by the power structure of straight white men, you know, diversity becomes a gift that the authorities are bestowing on you, and you've sort of lost half the battle. The only other thing I wanted to bring up in relation to the quote from Tony Scott and Manohla that you read, and I thought that was a really good piece, and they actually did start an interesting conversation. They didn't just say it to get out of trouble. But what... one of them, I believe, said, you know, well, changing demographics are going to make this change inevitable. And I have to disagree with that, because I was looking into this and I found a Variety story that said that theater owners had recently discovered that in the 20 major urban markets in the country, as many as 40% of their theater goers were African American, and that this was major news to them and would inevitably have to be reflected in the kind of movies that studios would make. And that story was from July of 1967. The demographics have always been there. But like, you can't just, it's like saying let the marketplace decide. It's a cop-out. You know, a real effort and change in thinking has to be
maybe. I mean, maybe. I'll challenge you a little bit on that. Okay. Because John Fithian, who is the head of the National North American Theater Owners Association, NATO, he is a feminist. And he is outraged that the film buyers and the exhibitors are, you know, sort of upholding this resistance to diversity. And he talks about it at length. And he talks about, you know, this is a different section of the pipeline, and we don't hear about that section that much. It's more invisible to all of us, but it's very real. But I, you know, I work with a lot of women directors. And I'm in the room pitching, you know, female-driven content, and I'm, you know, having the casting conversations, having the writer conversations, you know, having the finance conversations. And it just really started to just sweep over me as you know, things have been changing in the last, you know, let's say 3 or 4 years. That there are myths that are just being perpetuated, that women don't open movies. Hello, let's look, you know, now we're seeing it with The Hunger Games, with Twilight, with Lucy, with all different kinds of movies at all different budget levels. And so, you know, I chair the Women's Impact Network for the Producers Guild, and we represent 7,000 producers in America. And I said, you know, we see all of this, and this is an opportunity for us to take all the little studies and research and the data and pull it all together in one place and make a case. But let's forget about the sexism and the, you know, and the anti-diversity efforts. Let's make the economic case, because it was clear to me that while perspectives are being undervalued, that audiences are underserved. And if they're being underserved, then money's being left on the table. Right. So surely, in a business that's all about profit, we can speak to the bottom line. So we worked this last year on putting the Women's Impact Network, we partnered with Melissa Silverstein and Women in Hollywood, and we put together what we call the Ms. Factor Toolkit, the power of female-driven content. It's 30 pages long. We released it 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. So you can, I've got cards that have a link for it if you wanna see me after the show. But when we talk about the shifting demographics, we talk about what's happening, because you know what, you know, if you just look at across all industries, you know, women are making less than men today, but in, you know, we're talking about in 10 years that women will be out-earning men in America. Women go to the movies more, we watch more television, we're on social media more. We're becoming more educated, we're out-earning men in degrees. I mean, it's just a fundamental shift that's happening with the change in the workplace and the way we raise families. So anyway, I just wanted to challenge you a little bit, because we're taking this momentum as an opportunity to say, hey, you know, let's look at it in terms of money and debunk the myths that female-driven content isn't profitable, that women don't open movies, because they are myths.
They are myths, but I feel like they've been being debunked for a long time. Like, I've been hearing the same, like, and I the statistics and that, you know, women-led films out-earn by this much, and I've been hearing it for a long time, and the problem there is it's a self-policing town, and they're not policing. What are they self-policing? I mean, it's like basically, it's like this kind of white male patriarchy that has a lazy boy strapped to their ass of comfort, and they don't want to get off.
I don't know. I mean, I don't want to monopolize, but I'll just say one other thing is that there's another thing that's happening, which is the shift from domestic to international in our revenue stream, and that's a very important. It's what's happening with, you know, the digital platforms and piracy and the crash of DVD and the growth of local film industries. I mean, whereas domestic used to be 70% of a film's revenue, you know, international is 70% of your revenue. So the studios, who are the longest, You know, they take the longest to turn the ship around. I mean, I think as indies, we've known this for a while. They're starting to do and think about things differently. And I've just wrapped a movie with Disney that Mira and I are directed, and it's an all-African movie with an all-African cast. Yes, we were greenlit with Lupita Nyong'o and David Oyelowo, but we, you know, are telling a very, very different kind of story for a studio, and I'm very aware that it's a bit of an experiment for their brand, but they recognize that they have to make movies for international audiences. They cannot make middle American films and survive.
As a producer, Ira, and as someone who has not only produced for decades but started companies that have released, I'm thinking of Fine Line or Cinecom, companies that have released films into the marketplace, I wonder if you could give us a little bit of context and also from an academic perspective, how you look at the moment we're in the context of some of the other moments we've been in.
You know, it's funny, every time Eugene asks me a question on any subject, it always ends up with the academic perspective somewhere in there. Okay, well, let me just say that thinking back to, you know, the 40 years I've been in this business, I feel like I've seen this panel like 40 times. Yeah. And the thing is that first of all, it's astounding that we still have to have the conversation. But the second part of it is that there's really, you know, what sort of speaks to Matt Damon's response and a lot of what you were talking about also, about how the studios fall back on rationalizations that we hear over and over and over again that are essentially self-fulfilling prophecies. I mean, you can't expect audiences to come out on a regular basis unless you're making movies for them. You know, that's the bottom line. And if you only make movies for one particular audience, then that's the audience you're going to get. So it becomes self-fulfilling. I think that the only signs that I see at this point that would argue against the reality that we're going to slip into yet another cycle of people forgetting about these successful movies and going back on their old habits are some of the things that have already come up, but one is social media, the fact that there is a way for people to push back in a much larger way than was true earlier on. The changing demographics, I think, is also part of it. But I think most importantly, and this speaks to what Lydia was saying about the economics of it, is that the old model simply isn't working anymore. And every time, I mean, when there's major change in Hollywood, it's only because what they're doing by habit stops working. And I think that we're reaching a point where this mass audience way of mass audience, meaning like this is a movie for all young males. That's the audience that the studios have been chasing since the 70s, that paradigm isn't really working anymore. I mean, you know, you for every big superhero movie that gets released and makes a couple $100 million, there's two or three that are failing at the moment. And so the reality is that the advertising methodology that they used to use isn't working because advertising's falling apart in the age of the internet. There's just no way to create the same sort of mass audience response to something. And so when Donna Langley at Universal says, well, look, you know, the way that I'm going to deal with this is rather than take a $200 million bet on another superhero movie that I don't know whether it's got franchise potential or not, let me just take some smaller bets on other audiences and see what happens. And then you end up with the biggest summer in, you know, of any studio. So, you know, it does give me hope that maybe it's not one of those things that's just going to cycle back around again where everybody's going to forget that the audience exists, that maybe there is a change afoot.
I look to Mark because he's someone who writes and has written about the studio system in different decades, in books and in articles. I mean, how do you think about this?
I tend to think the studio system will change when the population of the people inside the studios, not just running them, but at every level, will change. But one thing I just wanted to point out was that, you know, when we use the word diversity, we're actually lumping together a huge number of different struggles, each of which has different challenges. I mean, you know, in terms of gender diversity, you know, there's women are more than 50% of the population, and that's a huge advantage. There are other groups that are not going to change that much. I mean, not just African Americans, but LGBT diversity, which is something we haven't brought up, Asian American diversity, Latino, Arab American diversity. Yeah. I mean, these are different struggles with different challenges. And when we use diversity, what we acknowledge is that they have a common enemy. And that maybe we can share some of the, like, share some of the strategies for how to make things better. But there's never going to be a one-size-fits-all solution. And some of these struggles, there are things we all have in common with the struggle. There are also things that are particular and individual challenges to each group that we're talking about. And that's why in all of these panels we have not solved it. I mean,
but I think, I just want to echo, though, that I think not being the only one in the room, I'm really happy I'm not the only person of color and not the only woman speaking on a panel, because I usually am, and you guys usually are too, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And I think, you know, behind the scenes, once that happens, then, you know, when there are more people in positions of power, like Jill Soloway, she insists on hiring women directors only for Transparent. And I think she, you know, single-handedly is responsible for shifting that gender imbalance in TV. So I think that is what's going to sustain diversity.
Let's not forget Lady
Shonda. Shonda, of course.
Yeah, I was like, but the other thing is, I mean, I just want to say, because I feel like these types of panels and conversations are lovely, but I always leave them sometimes feeling overwhelmed and like kind of hopeless, because we talk so big. Like studio system, I've never been a studio system. I'm just trying to make my little movies or my television. I feel the steps that we can do right now, which is what, I mean, I'm gonna say like, that's what we do. I hire people of color, women, and people who are qualified. They have, and funny enough, people of color and women are qualified.
You mean it's a meritocracy?
Shocking. You know, I'm like, get out of here. So like, even though Matt Damon, I mean, the conversation happened and he was like, we do it behind. I was like, okay, I'm not gonna be able to change that, but it's my company, I hire, I sign the checks. I'm gonna hire you, you and you. And that's what I feel is making that change, because people can make a black film or a Latino film or whatever, but everybody behind the scenes is Lily White. It defeats the purpose.
Absolutely.
It defeats the purpose.
Absolutely. We, you know, when I'm working, I work with Alicia Keys, so we're doing promos
I love her.
And videos and all these.
Her Levi's, I'm like.
Just movies
right.
or TV
I love
shows.
Her too.
And one of the, you know, we were working on a promotional video once, and the company we were working with sent over this list of all these, you know, directors that mm-hmm. we could choose from. And I went through them, and they were lovely, you know, artistic, and I thought she would like them. And then I noticed that it was all male names. And I just shot back an email. I thought about it for a second. And then I thought, no, what the hell am I doing here if not to like annoy these people into at least acknowledging there could be a woman director? And
did you get the get? Because I often ask that of like looking.
No,
I say forget available. I've had many, many people for below the line, and the agents are like, what? I'm like, have any women, people of color? And like literally stumbling over themselves at major agencies, and I'm like, we are out there, like go and get them, but they're just not there, but we are there. They're just not being represented.
Absolutely. I mean that I'm.
And it's shocking. And I remember even having to go to eight. Sorry.
No. I mean I have. I'll tell it. It's a story that happened to me at Sundance this year after seeing the movie Dope, so which was a great movie, diverse cast. Black male director, and I went from that movie into another screening. And in that screening, you know, the movie hadn't started, so everybody was chitting, you know, chitter-chattering and gossiping, and there was a woman standing right in front of me, a white woman, talking about how great Dope was. And she was talking to somebody who actually worked with the director. And she's having this conversation about how great the movie was and how you need to get Rick a movie that and we need to change that movie. We need to, you know, get him a comic book, but change it. Oh, and you know, he needs to be with the Tyler Perry family.
Oh, I know.
And this is the thing is, this is a person who has a real job at a real production company and has real power there.
Right, and they're dangerous.
And they're dangerous. And
they're
very dangerous to us, the
audience.
Because this person has the responsibility of going back to her little office in Hollywood and writing lists about who can direct this movie. And if she only puts Rick on a movie that is with black people, well, what does that do for his career? I mean, we're great, and we can make a great movie about us, but like,
we should be
he
able
could
to make
also a make a movie with white people in it.
Absolutely.
I was so upset. I mean,
the world
not
is just people.
Just black and
just
white,
people.
But yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it just, to me, that moment crystallized everything that was a problem, because she didn't see anything wrong with it at all. I had to stop her and say, excuse, did you see the movie?
Well, what's great is that you were in the room. Like, there's a certain thing of, well, you know what I mean, of mm-hmm. sometimes, and this is really upsetting, sometimes being the only woman or person of color, or a down white man, because I know you got this, but
gay,
sometimes,
gay.
You know what I mean? You know what I mean? You got
down,
this.
I'm
gay.
Not the patriarchy. I'm
you
gay.
Not,
I like
exactly.
guys.
That's okay. There you go. Look at him. Look at him. He's claiming it. Yes! I love you. So, like, drop the mic. But sometimes we have to be the spokesperson. Do you know what I mean? And like, and it's like, an I am nobody's role model. I am nobody, like, I am not, I'm not politically correct. But sometimes I've had to been like, all right, let me tell you what's jacked up about what you just said. You know what I mean? But you have to sort of quietly get over it, do you know what I mean? And be like, and then you can sort of change them one person at a time. But you have to be in that room in order to change that point of view.
I'm in those rooms a lot. I just came from a meeting at Paramount a week ago, and there's a woman who's the head of, I don't know what, something big. And she was laughing when she got off the phone. I'll give you a tiny behind the scenes moment of women in Hollywood. And this is a woman in power. And she was laughing when I came in and still on the phone. She said, ah, ha, 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 sorry. Hang on. Oh, Rose, this is such a funny story. You'll get a kick out of this. My friend who's the head of casting here, don't worry, he's gay. Just got his movie cast. I'm really happy for him. He cast all the main roles, but what he does, and this happened on a TV show I was on all the time, is they invent a role for the bikini girl. So the women have to come in audition to get in bikinis for the role, and that way they get all the men that need to make all the decisions in the room, and they can make the decision on what men to cast.
Ooh.
And this is a normal fucking Tuesday afternoon. So you're goddamn right I'm angry right now. I'm sick of it. I'm really, really sick of it. And and it's okay, he's a gay man. Now, and I said, what, your friend is actually a pimp. Your friend is trafficking on female bodies. And your friend is disgusting, and I'm sorry, so are you. And I got up and walked out. I doubt I'll be working with Paramount. I'm okay with that.
Damn. She must have a savings account.
So there's that.
And drop the mic.
And Hollywood. The stuff I've seen would make hairs curl, and I'm sure the stuff a lot of us have seen, but coming at it from the perspective of like the person that they consider lucky to be there, yeah, it's a lot. For an unprotected girl in Hollywood for many years, I can tell you I've seen some things.
Like this, but now we all want to know, like what else? I'll talk for y'all, because I'm like this. And I know I'm there, and I'm like, I know I heard some stuff, but like, what did you?
We'll talk.
In the comments that Manohla made that I read earlier, she referred to a report from the Directors Guild, and it struck me because she wrote, there's talk of a modest, quote-unquote, improvement in the number of women hired to direct for television and the internet. So the natural question that I had, is the future of diversity to be relegated to the smaller screen?
Or is the future in the smaller screen?
I was like it was a 2% improvement over last year and for TV, and a 1% step back for people of color. So, but yeah, I don't know. I feel like film is very behind TV. I think TV, especially this season, seems to be a lot more diverse. I feel like film is becoming like theater. I mean, it's continuing to become like theater, uh-huh. where it's a very rarefied art form that is for white people mostly, unfortunately.
That's interesting. I mean, I also, sorry, go ahead. I feel that no matter what, TV is challenging film no matter what. Forget diversity or whatever. It's just that you're able to do, in my opinion, longer form content and able to get more into the character. So TV is making a huge challenge no matter what. I love the fact that you have powerful women showrunners who are making sure, and even like Lee Dan, like people are making sure that we are people of color and inclusion. Diversity might be a different, I'm gonna start trying to use the word inclusive because people like diversity and they fall deaf. but of getting more people involved. I feel that, like, and just on the economics of film alone, like, I'm the queen of the little movie and I'm over it. Like, it's so rare to make money on a little movie, and it's so hard to make money on a little movie. So the internet and also doing TV, I think, is the way to go no matter what. And the fact that we can be there and hold down the fort, I love it.
I don't think we're just there. I think we're actually kind of kicking ass.
Yes! And that's
like, I mean, if Empire is the number one show on broadcast TV right now, and now everybody, and they have actually for the past few years since Shonda started kicking ass.
Shonda.
Scandal, How to Get Away with Murder, right? Like, we black women in TV are actually quite...
Janine Barwa. There's a lot of...
There's other showrunners. I mean, this is the space that we can own. And people want us
because,
to
you know,
be
it's so funny because, like, men, and this is interesting, I feel that, like, men, the studio system has been so male that they sort of, like, remember, like, it wasn't cool for stars to do TV? Oh, yeah. Do you remember that? Do you remember that back in the day? And now, and, like, I felt like they were like, oh, who cares about TV? And they were doing the studio. And little did they know, we're like, we're kicking ass over in TV. And now we're formidable.
That's right.
I want to be formidable with them.
I think that one cool thing that's happening in TV is that in certain categories, including women of color, we're getting to this point where there's actually freedom to fail. Like, if one of these shows, because saying, like, you know, give us a chance, we'll prove it, we'll make a success, it's like a great economic argument, and it's also a devil's bargain, because it invites people, when something flops, to say, well, see, you know, we tried Viola Davis, it just didn't work. Now, there's so much going on in network TV that if one of these new fall shows flops or whatever, people aren't going to say, oh, well, you know, we just can't do it anymore. And freedom to fail is
that's
a quality
huge.
Because no one ever says, well, no more movies with Adam Sandler. I mean, it's like, you know.
Pity that. I worked on
tell us a story about that.
I can tell you lots of stories about that. I worked on a female-led show the longest. I was on it for 5 years. Five long long years. And it was on for 8 years. It's the longest running female led show in history, which it's gotten no props for, but I'll give it that. And it had only two female directors in the entire 5 years I was there. And they were both submarined by the crew and certainly by the boys club behind the scenes. And they literally said, well, we tried a female director. And I'm like, that's like saying, oh, well, an Adam Sandler movie bombed. We're not going to do it again. You know what I mean? Like, come on. Like, it's just like, it's time to wrap the microphone cable around their necks and just drag them from the fucking room.
I love how militant you are.
I am militant.
Like, she's all like,
my dad said I was born with a fist up, and I have to say, I really am. I always have been like that. I'm a soft and lovely person when I don't want to punch people in the face. But right now we're talking about a subject that makes me angry, so there you go. And you know, it's okay. We're also not used to seeing women angry. We're not used to seeing that, because I saw myself on an interview, like, for Broadly, this Vice thing, and I was the only one that was kind of blistering, and I was at first even shocked by myself. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, what's weird about this? Oh, wait, we're never used to seeing women actually angry, unless it's, like, angry at a man in a scene.
Totally. Or being angry in business, or having, like, on Project Greenlight last week, I had an interaction with one of the mentors, and it was interesting because to me, I didn't curse, I didn't raise my voice. When I get into conflict, I start talking like this, and I talk like my mother, and I get very clipped, and I get to the point. And it was interesting because I was treated like, oh, she is angry, and I'm like, this is not angry. I'm like, if you want to see angry, this is, you know. But like, but it was really interesting how we're not allowed to have that type of reaction.
At all,
which was really interesting.
Like, stop taking my voice away.
And a man can have that sort of, and a lot of women executives, not just in film, but a lot of female executives have this where it's like where you speak and they can hear screaming, or if you're being aggressive, like when it's like, I need a cur-, like, you know, then you're like, oh, it's not good. We need you softer. It's like, what the hell? Can I just be me? And they're like, no.
I think, and I'm like, I don't care.
The director numbers are like the toughest, I think, across the board in the industry. And the writer numbers in television are some of the most promising.
And right, don't you feel?
Well, producing has always been kind of a bastion for women. Like the one area.
But although
it's only 25%.
In films, we're like at 25%. Yeah. But in television, it's higher.
I guess compared to
And it's higher in...
And cinematographers.
And I think the information, and you know, we focused a lot on this in our toolkit, is that, you know, what happens when you have a female showrunner, and what happens when you have women writers, and then how does the presence of women characters and the stories change, and access to your audience.
What was the show that a female showrunner was there, and that most of the writers' room was women, and then she left, a man took over, and then all of it, the whole. Am I making this up? Mm. I might be. Was it? Yeah. And then it just sort of tanked. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then they're just noticing that people hire people that they know are like, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think other people have talked about this. When I was watching the Emmys, and the Game of Thrones guys won their mm-hmm. Emmy for writing and producing, and they got up and they thanked HBO for giving the show to two guys who didn't know what they were doing. And I thought to myself, that's so interesting that they would give two white guys their own show, but they wouldn't give Lena Dunham her own show. They put a man on the show with her to be the showrunner. You know, they.
I think Jenny Connor is really considered the showrunner with
Jenny,
Lena.
That's right. Yeah. But they had to put, you know, Judd on as well. With Shonda Rhimes, the first show that she did, Grey's Anatomy, there was a man on it the first year.
I can honestly say if a man had directed my film, been nominated for Grand Jury Prize at Sundance, and qualified for the Oscar, he'd probably be having things coming out of his ass right now. And it's not the case. I'm fighting my ass off, but it is so glaringly apparent, it's literally embarrassing. But it's not embarrassing to me, it should be embarrassing to them. Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's all, you know, what you're describing happens a lot. You know, I think that opportunities are given to newbies who are white men, and, you know, whether they're directors or writers or stars, you know, Hollywood is willing to put their money, marketing dollars, behind an unknown white guy, the guy in Stonewall. Who is he, you know? Wonder Woman, who is she? Gal, whatever, I can't even pronounce her last name, but they will not put their P&A dollars behind an actor of color. You know, they'll just lay back on the excuse of, oh, they don't sell overseas and nobody knows who they are. Nobody knows who Jeremy Irvine is. Nobody knows who Gal Gadot, is, you know? And it's just, we're not given the same opportunity, like Viola Davis said in her Emmy speech. It's like, we need the opportunity, and we just don't get them.
This is becoming a downer conversation. How can we get the opportunity? Let's lift it up.
What do you guys think?
I want to see. I actually do want to. I already want to make a point before we take some questions.
Well, no, I was just going to say that this is the aspect of things that has. I've never even heard a rationalization that made sense. Mm-hmm. You know, when you hear about those sorts of things where some 18-year-old who made a short film ends up getting do a $100 million superhero movie. And then you talk about the struggles that you're having with an award-winning film. I don't get
it. And you have experience in the business.
I've spent over 57,000 hours on sets and studied every aspect of filmmaking. Yes, I do, actually. And it is depressing. Sorry. It is depressing. I mean, it's depressing. But also, I'm going to fight the good fight, and I'm going to put stuff out there, and I'm going to make stuff that counts, and I'm going to make stuff for us, because that's what we need.
But there's been, again, trying to be positive, there's been way more attention to this issue
there
recently.
There is, but it doesn't mean they necessarily know what to do with the attention is where it gets the disconnect.
That's the next step.
And even if we're talking about, like, Enlightened, I have two gay male friends that are showrunners, but they had to hire a straight guy showrunner to showrun with them. And then also these guys in the writer's room are talking. It's a feminist Latina show, supposed to be, but it's now radically changing to be the male's focus and point of view, and that they were discussing in the writer's room last week whether the lead actress had a hot enough ass, and whether, I mean, this stuff is real.
Yeah.
Really, really real. And I get it, like, a lot of times, I think producers, they're not, I don't know what goes on. I'm like, are you guys not in the same world that I'm in, or like room that I'm in? Because the stuff I know is like down and dirty, and like dark, like really dark stuff. And these aren't people that would supposedly you would look at and think they would be like that, because they wouldn't act like that around the outside world. But I get to, you know, it's
and I think
really
that, I think you know, Ira's right that these issues are really prevalent right now, and I think a big part of it is the bottom line. It has to do with the bottom line. It has to do with these films with women and people of color doing well. So I guess what you guys can do as audience members is just to be more discerning about the movies you watch. And, you know, don't go out and support white savior movies because we're so tired of those.
Yes.
And, you know, and I this kind of brings me to Game Changer. I wanted to speak a little bit about. You introduced it as an initiative, Eugene, which I hate that word because it's not an initiative. It's a company. Mm-hmm. It's a for-profit company that invests equity in movies, and a lot of people use the terms initiative and organization because it's a company that finances women directors only, and so automatically they think, oh, it's not a for-profit endeavor, it's a charity. You know, women are charities. So I just want to make sure that you guys know it's not an initiative, it's a company. We want to make money. We're investing in movies that we
will
sell.
Well, I see a little sell. Something right here, a little business being made.
Yes.
I'll
get out of the way.
That's what I was like. That's
and we've made four features so far. Three have premiered and sold, and we're in the black, which is great for, you know.
The one time black is good.
Yay. I think lots of times.
I want to see where the audience wants to go or what kind of questions they have. If you just promise me you'll wait for the microphone before you ask your question so that folks on the podcast and the video can hear. So maybe we can go up here in the second row, and then we'll work our way over to the other side.
Hi, I'm Lisa Kelly. This is awesome. This is a great, great panel to see. I was lucky enough to hear Ursula Burns, the CEO and chairperson of Xerox, speak on Friday at an event about minority and women-owned businesses. So my question that has had me thinking about this, hopefully, and I also was able to see Congressman John Lewis today, and he talked a lot about hope and the process. And a lot of the struggles that all different people have gone through. And so in the spirit of possibly hope coming out of this, I'm wondering what anybody's thoughts are about corporations. Does it have to be the studios? Because there are companies like, I don't work for Xerox, but I mean, obviously she was talking about a message of diversity and people giving back. You know, is there other places out there to get movies made where the money could come from, where there are other types of distribution? If it's a self-policing town, can we get out of that town and make movies somewhere else? I don't know if that's something that's even possible or something that any of you have tried or thought about, but I'm wondering if that's something that we could try to do besides just boycotting the next Transformers movie.
Which is, you're already going to do.
Well, me personally, yes. Oh, and last thing, just because this is awesome, if other people would possibly send out a lot of social media about this particular event since we talked about it, I think there have been some great quotes, and I hope there's a lot of promotion about what's been said here. Thanks.
Thank you.
You're talking about working outside the system. The answer is absolutely, and I think that's what independent filmmakers have been doing forever. I mean, I kind of come up doing that. What's interesting, and I love the fact that corporations are doing it as well. Like, I believe that Macro, which is owned by Charles King, isn't it the
Netflix?
Netflix, but also Microsoft woman, or the Apple woman.
Apple.
The Apple woman. Do you like the fact about the Apple woman?
Isn't that terrible?
How's that for disrespectful? Right, you know, I mean, it's actually, they're funding these companies that are about inclusion. So I'm all over that. And if any corporation would like to help finance Duly Noted Inc., I am more than open. So I think that's a really positive way to go. And I think we've been doing that.
But I think you can look to the international market, and, you know, I mean, the U.S. is like, I don't know, we're like down at number 29
right,
in
you
terms
keep saying
of
international
the status
with love in my heart.
Yeah.
You keep saying international, but they still have that thing of like black doesn't travel international, or if you're a person of color, women even, they're like, oh, you don't really do. It's still a battle over there.
Do you think it's true?
I personally? Mm-hmm. No, I don't. But do I think I have the sales people and the distribution people and the publicity people to make that not true? No.
Right. I mean, it was interesting, the conversation at Toronto this year is what is the future of international sales estimates, because the digital distribution, everything is changing so much that I'm very interested in that conversation, because most of my films get financed independently, and those sales estimates drive everything to do with financing. So, I mean, it'll be an interesting conversation to track going forward. But internet, yeah. I mean, international is the same thing. I mean, the Gina Davis Institute did a study this year. She took like the top 10 box office countries, and they ran the same numbers and pretty much got the same statistics that, you know, we've gotten here in North America. So the battle is the same, but I think that the difference is that we're living in a globalized world, and you know, we need to start thinking about, Ira and I were just talking about this before, in terms of movie, you know, and we saw it in the Michael Moore film, that people outside of America are less and less interested in America, and so, you know, there are ways to you know, I think that the international film labs are great places for young people to go, you know, take your scripts and workshop your projects and meet right. people and network. And the film that I did, The Lunchbox, with a young Indian director, you know, he did that like to the max. You know, we went to Cinemark and went to you know, IFP, and he was in the Berlin Talent Campus, and it just it revved up. So it ended up being a German, French, Indian, and I was the U.S. partner co-production. And his sole intention was to make sure that he reached an international audience. He didn't want to just be a small Indian film that didn't get out of the country. So it actually would have been much more efficient for me to just raise the $2 million in America and finance the film. But he really was committed to this structure because he wanted to reach a global audience, which you know, he was very successful. He was right. He was right with that approach.
Just to finish with your question, the financing out there is diversifying. I mean, the studios, of course, are still financing blockbusters, but, you know, Amazon, Hulu, Netflix, although those are being populated by old studio people, it seems. But, you know, like Refinery 29, BuzzFeed, Vice, and all these kind of new media, yeah. Condé Nast, they have their own video division, so I think a lot of, you know, media companies that weren't doing video are doing video now.
I just wanted to bring up Furious 7, as strange as it sounds, for a minute, because, I mean,
keep going. Absolutely.
The first time that title has ever been said at Lincoln Center. But, in a way, it's an example of how a movie can be one step forward in one area of diversity, one step backward, say, in gender representation. But this movie, with a genuinely ethnically diverse cast, yep. made more than $1 billion overseas.
Because it looks like what people look like,
right?
Minus the girl issue.
Absolutely. It's also set a little in Abu Dhabi, a little in Japan, a lot in Europe. I think for big high-end blockbusters, that movie 5 years from now may be seen as the start of a different future.
Mm-hmm. That could be. I mean, I have to say, I mean, for my mandate is I'm absolutely doing films with people of color and women and genre, thriller, action, sci-fi, horror. It's time for us to go that way. And that's where I feel that Fast and Furious 7, you know exactly what you're going to get. Mm-hmm. People will come and see it, and then you're just like, oh, look, it looks like America. Mm-hmm. Like, that's a twofer. I want to see more women in it. I want to see us having our own superhero. That's what I feel.
Yes.
There was another question in the second row, and then we'll work our way up.
I want to go with what he said, adding that, yeah, I remember this quote from a Spanish filmmaker. She's a female director. She's pretty famous. Isiar Boyain, I don't know who might know her, but she said something like she's tired of seeing people that consider her movie as a girl movie because she can make movies for male audiences. And yeah, I'm a writer. I can make characters that are extremely interesting, as many other men has always made stories about women giving birth when they have no idea what it is about. So I can write interesting male characters that might be even feministic, like they might be for pro-feminism. And that's something that we're bringing to the table that nobody else is doing. And with that, I want to say, I read yesterday through Huffington Post an article about Paul Feig. He's a director. I don't particularly like all of his movies, but I shouldn't say this because I might be working something from it. So exactly. Exactly.
We will all take
but,
a check.
But I'm just gonna say this because he did blockbusters as well. He did box office winning movies as Spy and Bridesmaid, I think. And what I liked about this article is so interesting because he said something like, you know, in my career, there was points that I got really down. Like, nobody won. I was a completely failure economically. Nobody wanted to put any money in my ideas. And that's something than many women cannot do. Like, and it's along with what we were saying. With meritocracy, we're not allowed to, you know, to fail. And that's what has to change of this society, really. Like, we need to allow ourselves, even, I'm sorry, I'm lately so in love with Amy Schumer and all that she does, because she's pretty much putting out there that she's clumsy, she's completely not politically correct, but not necessarily in an offensive way. Just, she doesn't take her seriously. And we as women, when we go, I might be an intern someday, and when I go to an interview, like, I need to be, like, there's many men, as you said, people who are given projects that they didn't even know what they're doing. I have to be knowing what I'm doing. I have to go there and, you know, like, act all like I know everything about any program, software, when probably even men don't even have to do that. They can start talking about whatever, and that would be. So my question would be, when have you found a situation when, like, you were told, and how do you respond to it, or how do you shift the conversation when you were told, well, you don't do things like men do, like, you don't look, that your topics are for men, you know? Like, they could also be interested in what you do. That's my question, sorry. That's it.
The way I do it is I just tell them they're wrong and why. That's me.
I think I have to be a little bit more savvy, because being black and a woman, do you know, and dealing with large sums of money, and I'm behind the scenes, do you know what I mean? I have to, usually I'm propping up my...
Yeah, I'm in my own weird category.
But you're a star, you know what I mean? You're a recognizable, people love you. You know, I'm trying to work within the system to get something done. And I think, honestly, like, I'm not trying to, like, plug the show, because I don't get paid from it. Like, I really, it's not. But, like, watching Project Greenlight is, like, a daily thing of, like, what someone, of a woman or a person of color, has to go through. And that's not even a hostile environment. But having the kind of conversations that you have to have, how you can't be like the rest of everybody else. You know, you can't be like a guy, because people are like, oh, now you're screaming, you're the angry. We have the angry black woman, right? So, and I'm not politically correct. That's not my... Yeah, right, but I'm saying, and then, just so you know, the whole movie's white. But that's what I mean. So I have to go one step further. And to be honest about it as well, I have to be twice as smart, twice as whatever, to get half of it. Do you know what I mean? That, like, that's just what it is. I don't have the liberty of going in and being like, I don't know.
And I also feel like I have to be the teacher for people. So I have to explain why your pitch might be really offensive, because it's about a magical Negro.
Oh my God, I want to do a movie about a magic Negro. Totally, it's like so real.
Magical Native American.
I have to actually, like, the fact that I have to explain that to somebody in 2015, and they're just like, can I Google? I'm like, actually, you can Google. There's a
white
home.
Savior. Even the white savior trope people don't know about. Yeah. Like, it's so basic.
But the fact that it's still happening now, and I know how it happened. I know that nobody on the other, you know, there were multiple agents and assistants and writers, and they're all one color. And they get to me, and I'm like, there's a problem here. And I'm gonna have to tell you what it is, and I'm gonna have to explain it to you, and then I'm gonna have to, like, maybe even not make money, because you're gonna be like, God, she's a pain to work with. But
that's your cross to bear.
That's my,
like, you have to be the role.
I'm gonna say it. I'm gonna say it, because otherwise they're gonna look like idiots. They already do, kind of. And then I can't be a part of it, but I can maybe change it.
Yeah.
A little bit, right? Like, maybe I can make an impact, and maybe they can be like, oh, you're making a good point.
You have to remember that, you know, we've had 100 years of movies starring white men. And, you know, white men are the stand-ins for every man, the everyman, yeah. As the writer of Noah said. That's why we cast all white people, because they're the everyman. And so white men are the only type of individual that gets afforded that power of individuality. All the rest of us, our race and our gender and our sexuality stands right before us. And, you know, I think a lot of people, we've been assaulted with these images of white men being the hero, being, you know, having the individuality, having the multidimensionalism, And this is like cultural imperialism all over the world. Mm. So you have to remember. So when people come at you with seemingly ignorant comments and things like that, oh, only women can direct movies, you know, starring other women, you have to remember that that's how they've been brainwashed that way over 100 years of images on screen.
Okay, where's our microphone? We can go, let's see. I do want to go towards the back. So do you mind if we go there and then we'll work back over?
Hi, my name is Macarena. I'm here with Agnes. We are both young filmmakers who are working on a short film right now. And as it turns out, just by coincidence, not because we tried, we have an all-girl team. We have a female producer. I'm a female director. Agnes is a female actress and writer. And we are totally confident. We're in pre-production stage, and we're confident about handling crew. We're more than used to it. And so we're not afraid about production, getting funding. We're working on that. But we are a little bit uncertain about distribution. Mm. And we are actually promoting ourselves as female directors who are trying to raise awareness about subjects that females go through. And our story is about a female who goes through domestic violence, which is something that happens to one in every 7 females in the US. And I just wanted to know if you have any advice for us as for distribution. Do you think that the fact that we don't have any males on the lead could be an inconvenience when presenting to festivals and trying to get our film out there?
Who's your target audience?
Would you accept an answer from a white guy?
More than just a white guy.
thank you. It sounds to me like you've got a really good angle that you actually could get you a lot of attention. And if the movie's good, I don't think you'll have a problem finding an audience for it. That's my feeling. You're talking about a short film, so we're not talking about trying to make $100 million at the box office. So that would be a different equation. But it does sound to me like you've got a really good backstory, and that's a big part of the battle.
Thank you.
I just want to mention that, when you go out to pitch your projects, at any given company, there's a number of different people that you might choose, or your producer may have access to pitch to. And it's a good idea to know who you're pitching to and whether you think they may have receptivity to the project that you're pitching. And, you know, when I had a teen girl movie, if I was going to be going to pitch where there were mostly men, I would try to find out if they had daughters. Preferably I'd be pitching to women. When we screened a cut for Disney of the movie that we have in post right now, I asked the executive to make sure that 50% of the people who he was watching it with were going to be women in the company. And I think that you have to think a little bit proactively about who you're targeting, who you're talking to, who's going to be responsive to the perspective that you're bringing to. And it's not easy. But most studios and networks do have diversity reps, and they're all different, and some are great and some are not so great. But I mean, HBO has Kelly Edwards,
yeah,
they hired her as an executive, her whole job is to kind of bring more ideas of, people behind the camera, as well as in front of the camera.
And also fostering new talent as well, the HBO Access program.
Yeah. So, I mean, everybody should try to get to know, if you're pitching your content, and if you're producers, or if you don't have a producer, you should get a producer. But you really want to try to focus and make sure you're pitching to in the right way, to the people that are going to hear it the loudest.
And I think oftentimes, really quick, sorry, to that end of pitching and getting to know and not just enlightening, but just shifting. And it's like, oh, okay. It's so many of these men, they're not these terrible men that are desperately trying to keep everybody out. It just doesn't occur to them. So just have it occur to them, and they're like, oh, okay. And then once it occurs to them, sometimes great things happen.
Julie.
I had a question. One, we've talked a lot about production and distribution and what happens before a film gets made. And I was curious to hear what you guys thought about how do we educate audiences? Because this is a very insular group to some extent. We're at the Film Society, we're in New York City. There are people who live all over the country and all over the world who go see movies. How, if given that something like Straight Outta Compton and Trainwreck have made more money than any studio thought they would ever make, there's going to be now, inevitably, 5 more Straight Outta Comptons that are directed and produced by white people, and there are going to be, you know, 5 to 10 other train wrecks that are produced and directed by white people. So the whole idea of having films that are diverse from an audience perspective, yes, that's happened. And so with studios being the ones who are the tastemakers, unfortunately, for most people who go to see movies, I wondered what your guys' perspective was on the idea of audiences. How do we educate mass audiences about these changes? Because if we don't do it there, we're kind of just doing all this in a bubble.
But see, I think the audiences are there.
Yeah.
And the thing that I, you know, why I am so excited about Effie exposing, you know, this disconnect is because that's the conversation, and I think that's the real work that we all have to do. And you know, the Sundance started a Women's Filmmaker Initiative with all these allied organizations that, you know, and they've been, you know, we're actually having there's a summit next week with, you know, with decision makers in Hollywood to talk about actionable steps to, but it's the education of the fact that the diverse perspectives is what brings the authentic story. Mm-hmm. And the authentic story is what galvanizes the audience. Because, you know, and you don't find your audience in one place anymore. So I think the potential is greater, you know, because we, you know, and we're seeing it a little bit in television. And I think that we just, I think it's on us. And I'll say, because I'm a little older, I've been doing this 30 years, so I don't mind sticking my neck out there because I'm only going to be doing it a few more. But I think we're seeing that with older women and people all over the place. I mean, what took Meryl Streep so long to stand out? She's got the power.
Mm-hmm.
But I think things are happening. I think the Sony hacking thing with, you know, with the pay disparity,
I think the
ACLU coming down and saying, you know, mm-hmm. maybe there is purposeful discrimination is the term. Mm-hmm. I mean, that scares the shit out of the studios. Right. So, you know, so I think all these things that are happening are really great, and we just have to keep pushing that disconnect, because that's the thing that I think will push it
like
over the edge.
But you know what's interesting?
No,
but what
I think
about
it's
social
like a chiropractic
media?
Like, adjustment really for the mind, and I feel like talking to people on social media, like for sure, having them literally, why don't you, if there's like another movie that's coming out that's like, God, another one of those, like I would like have every one of my Twitter followers like try to like text, like find the Twitter of the like studio head, just go after them.
That's what I'm saying, and that's what I'm saying, I do feel
or
this
the
is
marketing
a conversation.
People or somebody, just to wake them up, just shake them a little bit, it's not too bad, just a little bit.
Yeah, but you're shaking,
no,
not you. Like, she's like, I'm shook. But I wonder, like, is anyone like thinking about the call and response of the audience, like the Twitter, the Facebook, all of that, because that's where the I know I'm 43, honey. That's where the audience is. You know what I mean? Those are the people, and they are incredibly, I think, incredibly connected.
I think that there's a good example that just happened recently when the author of the new James Bond book wrote that Idris Elba was too street to play James Bond, and the incredible response that he got, just immediate, like, no, he's not too street, and by the way, he needs to be street.
As they say, it's street.
Like, but it was instant. It was instantaneous online, and he apologized.
Right. I think that's really interesting, but what's also interesting is that The Martian is like the number one movie right now and then some. So like, even though everybody was all in a flutter about Matt Damon, that wasn't enough to like stop a ticket. I mean, don't get it twisted. I will go see Jason Bourne, like just because I love it. But I just think that's, you know, just something to think about.
Yeah, yeah.
How do you then
but
that audience?
I think.
I'm not talking about this audience. I'm talking about people who live, you know, outside of New York, LA.
I think often the audience educates us. I mean, you know, Straight Outta Compton made $160 million domestically, which is way more than the people who made that movie thought it was going to make. Roland Emmerich makes Stonewall and makes this big, big speech about how he doesn't really care about reaching straight people. It's important to have a cute, straight-acting boy in the center of it because it's important to bring in straight people, and nobody goes. I mean, like, not that I don't think the public is always right. I don't think the public, the marketplace should determine everything. But I think the audience in movies and especially in TV has been sending a lot of messages saying that they are very, very receptive to diverse filmmaking and programming. And my frustration is in seeing how invested certain quadrants of the business are in not hearing that, yeah. In viewing every diverse thing as an exception if it succeeds. So I'm happy to let the audience keep doing its work. I think it's doing its work right now better than the people who are, you know, in charge of greenlighting stuff.
When you're talking about audience building, one point I want to make is just that it's historically, over and over and over again, when people have a really good experience at a movie or a television show, they want to repeat that experience. They actually want to go to see more movies. But the problem is that the follow-ups are always these cynical copycat movies that don't really get to the heart of what it was that was special about that movie. And instead, they just create some formulaic something, and the audience gets burned, and then they don't come back. And you know, there's a fundamental problem that's always existed with movies, theatrical movies, as opposed to, and this is the reason I believe television is so successful right now, which is that every time you come out with something, you're starting from scratch in terms of trying to audience build. What television has finally caught on to is that when you serialize something and somebody has a good experience, they keep coming back over and over and over again. Nobody's figured that out for theatrical movie going yet. Although film festivals sort of get at it a little bit, or you know, things like that, but it's not, you know, we haven't come up with a structure that gets over that inherent problem of having to start from scratch every time you put a movie into the marketplace.
But that's also, don't you think, possibly the inherent problem of who's behind the scenes?
Well, of course, but again, it's like, you know, you give audiences something authentic that they really like, and
well,
they
then it's
want
the
more.
Cynical, right? But then it would behoove these people to then go deeper and broader and think, ah, if this is the audience, then let's reflect that behind, and then there's an organic and true voice coming out of it instead of the cynical, like, number cruncher voice, which people are savvy enough and feel and don't like, and it's a turnoff, and they've been doing that since time immemorial. But it's obviously, if there's a reason that it's not working, and I don't believe the paradigm is working for them, maybe it's time to change. That's all.
I
know you're not
going to
disagree with me, but that's the only part where there's a disconnect in their brains. It's like, instead of looking out at the audience, they might need to look inwards at themselves and maybe see what's around them and next to them.
We're going to go just a few more minutes, but I want to ask one more question of the panel, and then we'll take a couple final questions. But it was that call and response that led us to want to gather this group today, and in particular around the dialogue that was brought up around what happened with you, Rose, and the situation with your representation this summer, Effie, with you on Project Greenlight just in the past few weeks. And I wonder, just to follow up on the point we were just making about this kind of call and response, this kind of immediate conversation that can be instigated, and how to harness that. What has surprised you most, the two of you, Rose and Effie, about the dialogues that grew around each of you, positively or negatively?
Ooh, that's really interesting. I mean, I have learned that people can say some terrible, terrible things on Twitter. And can hurt your feelings real, you know. I will say what really surprised me is that, and this is, I don't want this to sound condescending, that you guys got it. Like, I really did think that I was alone. I really thought that I was alone of, like, with that whole diversity comment. I was like, well, maybe, like, Black Twitter will get it. Do you know, for real, and I even said that when I talked to the HBO, I was like, Black Twitter is real. I'm not kidding, I really said, you need to make sure that, like, but what really made me feel great is that, like, it grew. Like, you know, I'm getting a little, like, it became a bit of a moment, and everybody, like, Black, white, Asian, everybody was, in my opinion, came out and was like, this doesn't make any goddamn sense. So, and that's what really surprised me. What also surprised me was that there is a whole contingent of, like I call him like right-wing man is what he calls himself, like how that made some people come out hard, like come out where I was a little nervous of like, I'm not a star. I'm like, do I need to protect myself? Because people get really irate when you challenge their blind spot or you challenge their icon. So that was really deep for me. And then the other thing is, what's also interesting, I love HBO, I love the experience now, but I still haven't heard from Matt Damon. I haven't heard a goddamn thing. Do you know what I mean? And it really hurts me because I have to say, like, it really, starting the show, he was one of the people that I was super excited to be with, because I knew that he's so smart. He's so, I don't care what anyone says, he is very intelligent, he's very thoughtful, he's a super cool guy. And then just to be like, wow, you must think I'm the fucking devil. Do you excuse my language? But like, not, just to be like, and then like in tonight's thing, I really got to see like, oh, you really just don't like me. And I don't know why, but I have a feeling it's because I'm a little too in my strength, I guess, or in my lane. Or you just might not like me. What the hell do I know?
I think it's just a weakness of character.
Yeah.
I don't think it has to do with you.
But everything's about me. I'm just kidding. I'm a narcissist. I'm just kidding. No.
As far as my thing goes, you know, I got fired by my agency after tweeting something about something that was just so banal to me that I thought it was like almost just so dumb it was amusing. And I think they weren't prepared for me to out them on Twitter. And I knew like the people that generally talk to me on there are pretty with it, very generally awake. I did Twitter something about the NRA the other day, so that brought a whole different boys to the yard, so to speak. Oh, good spelling. But it's been very, it's odd when you get to be part of the zeitgeist, like even just for like a couple news cycles, and it's a very strange sensation, made my stomach very tight. And I'm not gonna lie, when I got fired from my agency, I had this moment of like, like this stress. And then I was like, go fuck yourselves. I hate you. And I really do. I don't like everything you are, and I don't like what you stand for, and you make me sad. You make me sad that you're willing to be that kind of a weak person, and that you're willing to live that kind of a weak life. I actually am more sad for a lot of these people than I am angry, because it's just like, what a crap way to experience humanity, through that kind of like scared, like kind of male perspective that's like scared of anybody going boo or like stepping out of line. There's a real thing, the way they treat actresses in that town, and I will say it to a lot of the female producers and people that I know, that the ones that I've met that are kind of in the boys club mentality, that actresses, you get treated like you wear a short skirt, you deserve it.
Ooh.
And that's the number one, they start there. And there's a deep problem with disrespect, a deep problem. It's like, no, I'm a human and I'm an artist. I am no better and no worse than you. You will not treat me this way, not anymore. So that's where my stand is.
We are almost out of time, and I think what I'd rather do to wrap up is give anyone on the panel a final moment to comment or reflect or answer to or ask about anything we've touched the surface on today. I know that it's an ongoing conversation. It felt like for us at the Film Society that we couldn't not have this conversation, that it would be blind of us not to try to engage around some of what we feel is being talked about a lot right now and should be talked about even more. I wonder if anybody wants to comment.
I'm encouraged, actually, because I think that we've had a lot of, we have had these panels, we've had these articles, and you know, you feel like it's just a lot of talking heads, but I just read about the Blacklist, partnering with the Athena Festival on scripts. You know, they're going to do a program where they're getting scripts by people of color, and game changer. Like, there are things happening, and I believe that it's going to make a positive difference, and it's going to be slow, and it's not going to be as fast as we all would hope, but I do think that there is something really, really positive happening, and I think Donna Langley kicks fucking ass too, and we need to like make more copies of her. That's the last thing.
Yeah.
I read a great interview last night on IndieWire with, I'm not sure how you say her name, but I think it's Mia Taylor, who's one of the two stars of this really great indie called Tangerine. Did any of you see it?
That
came out this year. It's a really, really great movie with two trans actresses in it. And the interviewer asked her what she wanted to do next. And I thought she was going to say something very political and platformy. And she said, I want to make a horror movie. I just want to run and scream and die like all the other dumb bitches. And I loved that because it just reminded me that, like, everybody's diversity struggle is different. Everybody is running their own race at the same time as they're trying to fight for the cause. And that's all I got.
I want to add something about the thematic content of movies that we all might make. You may have realized that when the Supreme Court legalized gay marriage, that there were cover stories on just about every publication where the media and the film business and television business were all self-congratulatory, talking about how they made the difference. They were the ones who, like, you know, set the stage for all of this to happen. And, you know, there's a little bit of truth to that. I mean, I don't think that they deserve as much credit as they were taking, but I do believe that you know, media, culture, movies, television actually do put things out there that help to change the general atmosphere. And I do think that this kind of boorish, male-dominated thing is more than just the personalities behind the scenes. The way that things are portrayed in these movies, I had a big conversation with my daughter the other night about the fact that, and by the way, we mainly agreed, although she was being more tolerant than I was, but about this series of movies that were constantly being fed, even at film festivals like this, where somehow boorish, awful behavior is justified simply because somebody did something that was really genius. And I just, I'm not going to name names, but I just feel like there's an aspect of what we're talking about that is deeper in the culture than just simply what is being done in Hollywood or even in independent film or in television or anything else, that we could actually make a difference in a different kind of way by making movies that make the point.
I agree. I think we're putting things into a time capsule, so we better choose wisely. And thank you guys for coming out and being part of this. And I know at times pulling off a Band-Aid and looking at a scab isn't exactly like, you know, and sticking your finger in a wound isn't the most fun thing. But it's real and it's there. And I do believe, like, I know the audiences are there because I know I'm one of eight and I have the most amazing brothers and sisters who are married to very diverse people, if you want to use that term. And I know what they want to see and I know what's not being made. And these are also very savvy, very intelligent people. So just the more intelligence is put out there, the better for all of us, you know, behind and in front of the scenes.
I want to thank everybody for joining us today. And I want to thank Mark, Effie, Susan, Mynette, Ira, Rose, and Lydia for spending time with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.